Hello, this is a summary of today's lecture, what I have discussed today. So we are coming to an end of the course, and as I said, that this is your last topic, that is almost your convergence. So today I have discussed three things. One is some results and problems related to almost your convergence, and a very important law, namely the law of iterated logarithm in the context of almost your convergence. Okay. So let me start with the problem. I have a sequence of random variable xn, each with mean 1 by n and variance 1 by n square. So I asked what happens to xn as n is increased. So if you recall the definition of variance, so for any random variable x, ex square is variance of x plus expectation of x whole square. So from there you get exn square, in this case is 2 by n square. So now by Chebyshev's inequality, probability mod xn greater than epsilon is less than or equal to ex square by epsilon square. So this is 2 by n square epsilon square. Now is this summable? Yes, because it is dominated by 1 by some multiple of 1 by n square. So by Borel-Cantelli lemma, probability mod xn epsilon greater than epsilon occurring infinitely often is 0, and then this is an equivalent condition for the definition of almost sure convergence. So where does xn converge to? Here you see it converges to 0. Recall that what was the lemma? That xn converges to x almost surely if probability mod xn greater minus x greater than epsilon infinitely often is 0 for any arbitrary epsilon. So by that result, so this problem underlines a very standard way of proving almost sure convergence. If you can show that the mean is going to 0, the mean is going to 0 and the variance is also going to 0 at a rate 1 by n square or at a speed, so that this is a convert exn squares, when you add variance and expectation of xn square, if this becomes summable, then you can prove almost sure convergence of xn to 0. So therefore, this is how Borel-Cantelli lemma is used to prove almost sure convergence. And then I had told you that if x and y n are two sequences which are converging almost surely to x and y, then what happens to axn plus yn, xn into yn, xn by yn? Well, the answer is very simple. They almost surely converge to their respective limits, ax plus y. This follows from the algebra of limits. And basically, you see, this is just like this is what happens exactly in the case of pointwise convergence, right? If I have two sequences of real valued function fn and gn converging pointwise on the same, both defined, both the sequences defined over the same space or same domain, then essentially you will have this result. So this is no surprise. And then, I would ask you this slightly tricky question. Suppose xn is converging in almost surely and yn is converging in probability, then what will happen to axn plus yn? Okay, please think over it. The hint is that almost sure convergence implies convergence in probability, and you have already studied convergence in probability. You know that if this happens, both converge in probability, then these things will converge, but instead of almost surely, it will be convergence in probability. So the thing is that these rules hold whether the convergence is in almost surely or whether the convergence is in probability. Now the third and the most important thing perhaps in today's discussion is, suppose I have a sequence of IID random variable mean 0, variance finite, so let us take it to be 1. So you already know from weak convergence result that 1 by n summation of yi, this convergence actually what you have studied is that you have proved that when the variance is finite, this converges in probability as n tends to infinity. I told you that was weak law of large number. Now it so happens that the proof is slightly trickier. It involves Borel-Cantelli lemma. You can also prove that this all converges almost surely, and so 1 by n converges to expectation of y1. So it is true in probability as well as almost surely. Okay. However, if I now scale this, multiply this 1 by n summation of yi by root n, that is 1 by root n times summation of yi, then you know you don't get improbability convergence, rather you have convergence in law, and it is known as the central limit theorem, the condition being that the variance is finite. Now, so you know that how is the standard normal distribution? So, convergence in law means what? That for large n, this random variable 1 by root n times summation of yi, its probability distribution is similar to normal distribution. So, how is normal distribution? You know that although the normal distribution is supported on the entire real line, but essentially all the values are between minus 3 to plus 3, 99.73% values are between minus 3 and plus 3. So essentially it should behave like a bounded random variable, but although it's not. So this law of iterative logarithm kind of gives you kind of the bounds. So what it says that if I further divide it by log log n, so here you had 1 by root n times, I make it even smaller, a log log n, but log log n is an increasing sequence but increasing very slowly, then this ratio has two limit points, namely the limsup, that is the largest limit point is 1, and the limits, the other limit point is minus 1. Okay, so what does this information tell you? This information tell you that for arbitrary epsilon, if you take 1 plus epsilon and 1 minus epsilon, this essentially would work as bounds of this sequence for sufficiently large values of n. So in fact for all but finitely many values of n. So this is what essentially it is. Now these are random variables, these are not real sequences. So we have to make a probability statement, and that is what we that is what it essentially means, almost surely means with probability 1. So for any epsilon positive, values of 1 by root n times summation of yi, so we take this thing to the right, so minus 1 minus epsilon into 2 log log n and 1 plus epsilon into root log log n, this essentially behaves like the bounds of some tail of the sequence. So for all except finitely many values of 1 by root n times summation of yi will be between these bounds with probability 1. So this is a mathematical statement, and since you mathematics students, I am sure you understand it, but let me still show you through a simulation exercise. So what I have done here is that I have drawn 20,000 values from the standard normal distribution, each of size n. So first time I draw one number with mean zero variance 1, second I draw two numbers mean zero variance 1, and so on. So this n is varying from, first n is 1, then n is 2, then n is 3, then n is 4. In this way I have increased up to 20,000. So I want to see what happens to this thing when I plot them. So what I have done, I have simulated them here. So I have drawn the numbers following number, how many numbers, n numbers, each having mean 0 variance 1, and here I have this s3 is the value. So s1 is the mean, s2 is mean into square root of n, and s3 is this ratio. Okay, and now here is the plot of this s3, that is this is what exactly would look like if y1, y2, yn are iid normal, n01 mean 0 variance 1. So for 20,000 plots. So what was said that with probability 1, that means nearly all the values will be between minus 1 to plus 1, all except finitely many. Also you can see if you draw two horizontal lines 1 and minus 1, most of the values are contained in this region only. So this is what it result actually means. So what we have plotted, that 1 against of course you cannot put 1 here, so 2, 3, 4, and this way we have increased the values of n and plotted against n. So this is what the plot is. So you see most of the values are varying between minus 1 to plus 1. So this is how the result looks like, and if we slightly go beyond minus 1 and plus 1, say here and here, these will so it looks like a bounded, so the values are bounded, right? This is what the result takes tells, that for all except finitely many values of n. So this is the what this rule is all about.